morning. How are you? Okay. Someone's awake. We're glad you're here this morning, braving this sunny, cold morning, right? Well, you need to stand up, move around a little bit, say hi to someone next to you, bump them. We're glad you're with us if you're online this morning. Lori, give us some words of wisdom this morning.
Jesus loves you, Pastor Paul.
So Lori and I, we challenged our marriage yesterday. Every so often, you know, you got to do something that challenges your marriage. So we did our taxes yesterday. How many of you know what I'm talking about? If you wanna determine the health of your marriage, do taxes together, right? So we had to break about halfway through and then come back, finish them.
No, it's always good. It's good.
No, it was good. So we made it through. Now we just gotta now the hard part, right? But anyways, no matter where you are or how you're joining us this morning, we're glad you're with us. And we're just going to exalt and lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to join the crowd on Palm Sunday to worship and exalt the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, right? Isn't that why we're here? Yeah? Okay, so you're going to join Ooh. In. Amen. Would you open us with prayer, hon?
Lord Jesus, we just welcome you into this place, Father God. I pray that you would just anoint the singers, Lord Jesus, and that they would bring us into worship, Father, and we would open our hearts and our minds to you. Not that we would keep it to ourselves, but it would overflow as we go out of this place to our family and our loved ones and our friends around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's worship.
Out together. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was like time till I met you. I was breathing but not my failures I try to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glory.
Out of the darkness, into your glorious
my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your wondrous day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Lift him up this morning.
Yeah. humble King. You chose the road that led to suffering. Nothing was spared to prove your love for me. You're the mystery. Let your final breath became eternity. What we had lost forever, you redeemed. Oh. Forever. the moon and stars they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. When final breath can break, as heaven looked away, the Son of God was made in darkness. His battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The storm was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen.
We sing hallelujah.
lift you high this morning, God.
Yes.
We are so thankful that you sent your son to die for us. This week, this holiday, God, this is the culmination of our faith. And we can never repay you. So bless our service this morning. Bless our time together, God. Pray that you give us ears to hear and hearts to know what you're speaking to us. In your name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
There are religions all over the world that you go and you visit the tomb of some great person, someone who said something wise and profound, and someone who maybe changed the landscape of a part of the world or someone's life. But we have a Savior who didn't just die for us, but he rose. And we have this blessed hope that because he lives, we live. Because he rose one day, we too will rise. That the grave isn't the end of the story. It's the comma to what comes next that is better. Amen? That's the essence of Holy Week. That he lived a sinless life, but he gave that life so that we could have eternal life. Amen? Our sins are forgiven, and God no longer holds them against us. He sees the blood of Jesus. And Jesus looks at us and he says, we are made righteous. Amen? We could sing these songs and we could use other people's words, but we have to remember we got to stop and use our own words to worship the Lord. Amen? Amen. We're going to worship the Lord in our giving this morning. And as we do, I just want you to think about the many places the finances that we provide here go. They literally go all over the world in missions, in care ministries, here in Branford, the church, and the organization of the church. And so I know it's one of those things, oh my goodness, we give, and churches, they have offerings, but it's so much bigger what we all do in whatever proportion that God gives to us and we give back to God. God multiplies it. It says, shaken down, pressed down, shaken together, running over. And so that's our prayer this morning. Lord, we pray that you would bless this gift. Lord, some of us today, we give and it's tough. Maybe our job, we've lost our job. Maybe they're downsizing. Maybe it's just a lean week and we give and Lord, it's tough, but we're being obedient. And there's others of us right now, it's good and we're giving out of abundance. And Lord, we want to be generous with whatever place we find ourselves in. God, more importantly, we pray that you would distribute these funds and use them, whether it's missionaries and places Jeff and I were talking about, El Salvador, or Ukraine, or Asia, God, wherever, or right here in America, so many ministries that we invest in and are part of. Lord, we pray that you would bless those ministries, that they would flourish and the gospel would increase. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Sunday, but it's also a final Sunday for one of our family members this morning. Two of our family members, I guess. One family. Wanda and Raph, they're going to be moving on. Their family is worshiping. Their larger family is worshiping at a church together, and they want to be there. They want to worship with their family. So we want them to come on down here, and we just want to honor them this morning. They have invested so much as our greeters. And ministry leaders and part of the family here. We love them. We hate to see them. As a matter of fact, I think I'm going to chain them to the welcome desk. It seems like the best place to chain them. But you guys know this. You've seen this before. This is our. As a matter of fact, we were down in Florida recently, and we were there with, who were we there with? Jane and Al. And they had theirs out on the porch. So as we walked in, we saw their lantern. And that lantern's there to remind you that this is always home. The light's always on. You're always welcome. And that church that you're going to is not as good as this church. No matter who's there. And we love you guys, and we honor you, and we bless you, and we thank you for all that you mean to us and all that you've given to the church here. And we truly want you guys to be blessed. And we understand, you know, when the whole family's worshiping someplace and they came and they said, the whole family's there, we want to worship with our family. We totally understand that. And we love you guys so much. So please put this someplace where you remember us and think about us and pray for us. And always know the door's open. We'd love to see you again. Love you, man. Love you. Okay, please don't leave so you get a lantern. I'm starting to think, maybe this isn't a good idea. We'll just give you a lantern. I want you to stand this morning. I want you to say hi to someone. I just feel like before we transition here, say hi to someone. Maybe it's someone you haven't seen in a while or they're new to Shoreline. How about you let them feel welcome this morning? If you're joining us online this morning, we want you to know how glad we are to have you with us as well. Pray that you are being touched by the Spirit this morning in some way. And we pray that this morning's service is a blessing to you. If you're new to Shoreline, would you go to our website, sccbranford.org? There's a place there that you can fill out an online connection card and let us know that you're with us this morning. We'd love to know that you're with us this morning. Bless you. Amen. Okay, so I think there's a mistake in the bulletin. What happens when the pastor does the bulletin? There's mistakes. Thank you. Someone said it before I did. Let me handle that, okay? Jeez, jumped right in on that. Yes, they're right. The pastor makes it. Tonight, there is prayer. Is it in there? There's no mistakes. So, yes, tonight, 6 o'clock, prayer. We hope you'll join us, and as Vic likes to say, it's the fuel that powers the engine of the church, and it is, and we take that time. Can I tell you something? 2 weeks ago, we prayed for a young man, 16 years old, who had been doing some drugs, and there was fentanyl, right? He was in a coma, and we prayed for him right about 6:15, 2 weeks ago. That young man came out of that coma at 6:15, 2 weeks ago. Sat up, had no side effects, and by that evening was doing fine. That's why we pray twice a month, okay? So if you're here and you're like, I'm praying for something and there's no answers, well, I'm just saying maybe you might want to, if you've ever heard me use the illustration, if you have a little car out there and you need to push it from one spot to the other, you might be able to do that yourself. But if you had a tractor trailer and you needed to push that thing out of the way, guess what? You're going to have to get some people to help you. And you know what? There's some things that we pray for that we need to join our prayers together and push that response. So you wonder why do they come out twice a month and pray? That's why. Because God hears our prayers. And you know what? It's exponential when we pray together. There's power in prayer. So you wonder why I harp and harp and harp and harp and harp and harp and talk about prayer all the time? Because it's the difference maker. The churches that grow and thrive and see miracles, you want to know what they have in common? There you go. You know, they pray together. So come and join us for prayer. It's an hour. It's 1 hour. Twice a month. You can make that happen. Okay? Hey, on a lighter note, if you're here for the first time at Shoreline Community Church, my name's Paul Allen. I'm the pastor here, and I am so glad to have you with us. You may be online or here in person. We just want you to know that we don't take it lightly that you would take time out of your Sunday morning and come and be with us. It really means a lot to us. So I hope and pray and have been praying for you this week that you feel welcome, that you are enjoying the service, but more importantly than that, I hope you're having an encounter with a God who loves you so much that he sent his son to die in your place so that your sins could be forgiven. And that before you leave here today, I pray that that encounter makes a life change in your life. And that you get to make some new friends while you're here. So we want you to make yourself at home. I always joke about it. Put your feet up on the furniture. Make yourself comfortable. We're glad to have you with us. Here at Shoreline, we have a saying, the first time you come, you're a guest, and after that, you're? So please, please come and be part of the family this morning. Can we welcome our first-time guests this morning? Okay, quick reminder, next Sunday is Easter. If you haven't signed up to be part of the breakfast, there's still a few things left. I heard blackberries. How can we be short of blackberries? But anyways, there's a few things that they still need for breakfast. So if you can help out, please do. We have services at 6:30 down at the Point. That's going to be exciting. We love our 6:30 a.m. Can I tell you something? We've looked at the weather. It's going to be lousy all week except for Sunday. Isn't that cool? So we're believing that that's going to hold out, and it's going to be 80 degrees at 6:30 Sunday morning. You have not because you asked? No, I'm just saying. So even if it isn't, we'll wear coats and hats and gloves, but it's going to be a great time. We love, love, love our sunrise service. Then we'll be back here at 8:30 for our first worship experience, followed by a continental breakfast between 8:30 and 10 o'clock, and then 10 o'clock will be our final service. It's going to be a lot of fun. So I love Easter Sunday, and I love being together with you. So we hope you'll be with us. Bring a friend. So somebody asked me last week, how do you invite someone to Easter service? I'm going to tell you how to do it. You ready? Seriously, this is how I do it. I say this. I say, everybody has to go to church on Easter. So why not come someplace where we're giving you breakfast? Pretty good. You can use that. So, okay. So here's what it says in Matthew chapter 21, verse 9. It says, and the people around him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, the Sunday before Easter is called Palm Sunday, and it's scriptural that we call it Palm Sunday because here's what we read in John chapter 12, verse 13. It says, a large crowd of Passover visitors. Now, I want you to think about that. The Passover started all the way back as they were leaving Egypt. Remember, there was the plagues, and the final plague that God put on the Egyptians was the death of the firstborn son. And what he did was he made a provision for the Israelites. They slaughtered a lamb, they took the blood, they put it over the lentils and the sides of the door, and the death angel would pass over the Jewish homes, and all of the firstborn in Egypt were killed. The Passover. So this is what they're celebrating. Thousands of years later, they're still celebrating it. So a crowd of Passover, what were they? Visitors. They weren't normal people that were in Jerusalem. They weren't the people who lived there day in and day out. These visitors took palm branches, went down the road to meet him being Jesus, and they shouted, praise God, blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel. Now, that crowd, rightly, that day called Jesus the King of Israel because he was presenting himself as their king. And I'm here to announce to you that the king is coming. There's a day when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is coming again. Amen? Yeah. Christ the King is our only Savior. He's our healer. He's coming to save, and he's going to heal once more. There's a story of a little boy who got sick on Palm Sunday and stayed home with his mother. His dad went to church, and while he was there at church, he got a palm branch, as a lot of churches do. And I apologize if you've attended one of those churches in the past that do palm branches. I just never think about it until it's too late. Palm Sunday always like creeps up on me. So if you're one of those people who love it, next year you order the palms, we'll pay you back and we can have them. But I just... It's one of those Sundays that sneaks up faster on me, and then I'm like, oh, we didn't get palms. But anyways, that's the answer. So people ask me every year why we don't do palms. I don't have a really good reason for it. I just always forget to get palms. It's really quiet in here. Okay, so he goes, he gets a palm branch, and the little boy asks his dad, Dad, why do you have a palm branch? To which his dad said, well, when Jesus came into town, everyone waved palm branches to honor him. So we got palm branches today. And the little boy said, my good, oh, shucks, Dad. The one Sunday I miss church is the Sunday that Jesus shows up. Now, as you know, today is Palm Sunday, right? And it's marked by the celebration of Jesus coming into the city. And those that were there, they worshiped and they praised him. Now, this day's bittersweet for us because we join in the celebration with those in Jerusalem as he was coming into the city that day. But we also know that Friday is coming. The cross is coming. And we know that many of the same crowd on Sunday were there in just five few days. And they went from shouts of praise to shouts of death. From shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, and then later shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Now, I want to talk to you today about 2 days in a single week. The first day is Sunday, the day that we commemorate and celebrate today, the day that Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem with people shouting the praises and praising God for all the wonderful miracles that Jesus had performed. The second day, of course, is Friday, when a different crowd was shouting, give us Barabbas, we choose him, crucify Jesus. And it leads us to the question, why the change? And there's many possible reasons, and it may be as many different reasons as there are people. But at the heart of the matter is that their words didn't match their true feelings. The reason is because, listen, they possessed a casual faith. Can I tell you something this morning? They had just a little Jesus. They had just a little Jesus. I want to talk to you today about just a little Jesus. See, they had religion. They wanted miracles, but they missed the person. The one they had been looking for, the one they had been waiting for, the one they had anticipated was there. And they missed him. All of creation, all of time had converged in that moment. And they missed their opportunity and their visitation with Jesus. Why? Because they wanted what they could get from him, but they weren't interested and knowing him. Jesus said this in John chapter 10, verse 10. He said, my purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life, to which all of us would go, I'm in for that. I'll take some of that. Give me a rich and satisfying life. Absolutely. I want that, Jesus. But Jesus also reminds us in Matthew chapter 16, verse 25, if you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. Which means that the life of a Christ follower is a life of commitment. So I want to kind of dig in today. How can we have a committed faith? How can we move from a faith that loves Jesus when the crowds do to a faith that is committed even when the times are difficult, even in the moments when we're alone? Even when life isn't going our way or the way we want it to, and when no one else is with us. And so in your notes this morning, I want to offer you four keys to such a faith. To such a faith. The first key is this. How can I have more than just a little Jesus? First of all, if a little Jesus is good, then more is better. If a little Jesus is good, then more is better. See, in our passage this morning, the crowd praised Jesus as he passed by, but many of them had a different agenda. See, the crowds didn't know Jesus, they knew of Jesus. They knew the stories, they had heard the press, they knew what other people had experienced and were telling them. They didn't know Jesus. They didn't have a personal, intimate relationship with him. They weren't with him every day, eating with him, walking with him, sharing life with him. They worshiped Jesus when it was convenient. As Jesus passed by, they joined into the moment. And let's be honest this morning, they worshiped Jesus for two reasons. First of all, they worshiped Jesus because they wanted to see his miracles. They had heard that he had raised the dead, and they wanted to see if it was true. We see this earlier in John chapter 12. It says this, many in the crowd had seen Jesus call Lazarus from the tomb. There were people that were there. They saw Lazarus just a few weeks earlier come out of the tomb alive. And he had raised him from the dead, and they were telling others about it. So there's a commotion that's going on. There's gossip that's being told. The story is being shared. That was the reason so many went out to meet him, because they had heard about his miraculous sign. Now, maybe you're hearing like, I don't know. I mean, think about this. What if one of the royals all of a sudden was coming to Branford, right? Now, you may sit here and go, I don't really care about that. But I mean, let's be honest. You kind of like, that's pretty cool. I mean, I might go down and see them. I remember when we lived in Danbury, President Clinton came to town and was walking down the streets of Danbury, and people were coming up and saying hi to him and so on and so forth. I mean, it was pretty, they shut down Danbury for a day while we lived in Danbury. And then I remember another time, Bud and I, we had gone into New York City, and we went to see the show Stephen Colbert's Late Night. Whether you like the show or not, it was funny. So anyways, and we had happened to be there on a Thursday, and on Thursdays, they tape both Thursday night and Friday night. And so we were there, and we sat through the first taping of the show, and then all of a sudden, I leaned over, and I went, something changed. That wasn't the security guard that was there before. And I said I leaned over to Bud, and I said, that guy knows what he's doing. Now, I don't know who's coming out in the second show, but whoever they are, they're important, because that isn't your everyday security guard. I could tell. Didn't know who was coming, didn't know anything about him. Whatever your politics are, that's fine. But I could tell you something. It was Hillary Clinton, and the mood changed in the room when somebody important shows up. Whatever your politics are, whatever you feel about that person, all of a sudden, we could tell without anything being said, the room had changed. Listen, when Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, they had heard the stories. This dude doesn't just heal people, that's miraculous. This guy raises the dead. And whatever I feel about him and whatever other people, I know one thing, I want to get a glimpse of this guy while I can. And so, like the crowd, you know what we do? We settle for a little Jesus. We settle for the attractive parts of Jesus. The Jesus who heals the sick and raises the dead. And we bail on the things that don't go the way we want them to. Notice that the crowd praised him because of what they could get from him. Earlier, we see the crowds, he was feeding the 5,000 and the 4,000, but when he stopped feeding them, what did they do? They left. when he said, no, I don't have anything else to eat for you except for my flesh and drink my blood, they went, ooh, I'm out, right? When there was something they could get from him, they were in. But when Jesus called them to a level of commitment, they were out. Listen, the second reason they praised him was because they thought that he was going to free them from the Romans. Now, to be freed from Rome would have been like being set free from slavery from Egypt thousands of years before. And their praise was the result of an attitude that asked, Jesus, what can you do for me? Right now, the line I keep hearing over and over in politics is your life better now than it was 4 years ago, right? And they were saying, Jesus, how are you going to make my life better tomorrow than it is today? How are you going to set us free from Roman occupation? How are you going to get us out from under this tyrannical? What do you got for me? What are you going to do for me? And just 5 days later, we see his trial. And Jesus isn't riding in on the colt. Jesus isn't riding in victoriously. People aren't shouting and throwing palm branches and their coats in front of him. Now they see him beaten and disfigured, a man who no longer looked like a deliverer and a conqueror. And as lies were leveled against him, they quickly changed their position. See, for them, it was all about me, me, me. And I'm here to tell you this morning that Jesus came and gave more than just a little of himself to us. He gave his all. He gave up the glories of heaven, and he took on the form of a man. Not only the form of a man, but he came as a baby in a manger. He lived a sinless life so he could be the perfect sacrifice for our sins. And he died on the cross so our sins would be atoned for. And as we celebrate next Sunday, he rose from the dead so that we could overcome sin and have eternal life. He gave everything for you and me. Why then would we be satisfied with just a little Jesus? Why wouldn't we want all of him, to know him, and to be known by him? Just as he did 2,000 years ago, our King is passing by this way right now. And his offer is still the same. Exchange your life with all of its attachments to sin and death for my life, which is eternally abundant. And so it compels us this morning, give him our worship, our praise, our lives, our very best, and withhold nothing from him. Let's give him our all, because if a little is good, then just imagine how much better it is when we give him everything. Number two, second key this morning, is commitment is relational. Commitment is relational. Many of those who gathered to throw their coats and palm branches onto the street and shouted praise did so because it was the popular thing to do at that time. It's what we would say today. It was trending for that one brief moment, and they were caught up in that moment. However, just 5 days later at the trial, shouting crucify him was now the thing to do. In fact, for a moment, the popular thing to do was to make a mass murderer, an insurrectionist, and criminal their hero as they declared, we want Barabbas. See, to be a fully committed follower of Jesus starts by having a personal relationship with him. It's an everyday, fresh, growing relationship with him. And in order to have a committed faith, we have to develop and maintain a personal relationship with Jesus. Imagine if you came up to me and said, hey, Pastor Paul, do you have a best friend? And I said, why, yes, I do. My best friend's name is Jack. And then you asked me some questions about Jack. You said, well, where's Jack from? What are some of the things that you and Jack like to do? Is Jack a sports fan? If so, what teams does he root for? And then I said to you, well, I don't have a clue about any of those facts. As a matter of fact, I haven't seen Jack in 47 years, back when we were in kindergarten together. See, I don't see Jack anymore. And we grew up separately. I don't know about him because I don't have a relationship with him. And so often, we claim we're Christ followers, but we aren't following Christ. We claim we have a relationship with him based on something years and years ago. I walked down an aisle and I knelt at a stage or at an altar. I raised my hand and I said a prayer. I grew up in church. Whatever it may be, we go back to a moment in time. Back to my friendship, my great friendship with Jack, all the way back in kindergarten together. That's the way so many kind of describe their relationship with Christ. See, if I want to have more than a little Jesus, then I have to be committed to a growing relationship. Commitment is relational. Number three this morning. Third key. A committed faith is a tested faith. Committed faith is a tested faith. At the parade, it was trendy to praise. Everyone was doing it. But at the trial, speaking favorably or speaking out for Jesus was risky, even life-threatening. And many people come to Christ expecting Jesus to do what we want the way we want it done, right? So many Christians, our idea of a trial is sitting in traffic, right? And so we reason, well, maybe we'll experience a little discomfort, but not much of it. And here's what happens. Listen, church, here's what happens. When trials come our way, I want to help you identify whether you have a casual faith or a committed faith. I'm going to help you right now. If every time a trial comes in your life, you go, God, why are you letting this happen to me? God, why are you doing this to me? Can I tell you something? You have a casual relationship with Jesus. If, however, when trials come into your life, you lean in and you say, God, whatever it is, no matter what it is, I'm committed to you, I'm going to serve you, and I know no matter what I face, you are with me. You have a committed faith. If we blame God every time something goes wrong, you know what we're saying? God, it's about me, me, me. And I'm not interested in how you want to grow me. I just want to be comfortable. And you have a responsibility to me, don't you? Because I made you Lord. And that means I'm Lord, not you. Wait, isn't that right? It goes my way, not your way. My will, not your will. Isn't that what that means? No. It means, God, you know what's best. And I'm committed to you. See, if our level of faithfulness is contingent on our situations and circumstances, it will never be committed. It will always be casual. Listen, a committed walk realizes that God is in both the good and the bad. And a committed faith knows that we're all promised this, that during life, that he'll never leave us or forsake us. We're not guaranteed that it all goes our way and it's going to go easy, but that he'll be with us and he'll stand with us even in the trials and the difficult times. And I have good news for you. James has some comforting words for us this morning. He says this, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. Isn't that comforting? Huh? What are you talking about, Pastor Paul? For you know, listen, that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete and needing nothing. See, if all I have is a little Jesus, then I'm not going to be ready when my faith is tested. Remember Peter? Peter had his faith tested. Jesus said, hey, Peter, why don't you come out of the boat and walk on the water with me? And Peter went, that sounds like a good idea. Let's do this. And he jumps out of the boat, and he's walking on the water. And what happened? All of a sudden, it says, Peter noticed the winds and the waves. Hey, here's the part of the story I didn't tell you. The winds and the waves were already there before he got out of the boat. At one moment, he took his eyes off of the winds and the waves, and he put them on Jesus. He leaned into Jesus. It's when he took his eyes off of Jesus and got his eyes on the circumstances around him. What happened? He started sinking. Maybe this morning, the reason you're sinking under the winds and the waves in your life is because your eyes are on the winds and the waves and not on the one who controls the winds and the waves. Amen? There's a story of a little girl. She was walking through a garden, and she noticed a particularly beautiful flower. And she admired its beauty, and she enjoyed its fragrance. And she said, it's so pretty. I could see little Emmy or little Rosie, our granddaughter, saying exactly that. And she was kind of mesmerized by it. And as she gazed on it, her eyes followed the stem down to the soil where it grew. And she said, this flower is too pretty to be planted in such dirt. So she pulled it up by its root, and she ran to the water faucet, and she washed off the soil. And you know what happened next. It wasn't long before the flower withered and died. And the gardener saw what the little girl had done. Can you just imagine? Right? He said, you've destroyed my finest plant. She said, I'm sorry, but I didn't like it in that dirt. And the gardener said to her, he said, I chose that spot and I mixed the soil because I knew that only there could it grow to be a beautiful flower. Here's the good news. Listen, God has planted you exactly where you need to be to grow. And it means that you've got to trust him. See, when we trust him, we see that he is using our pressures, our trials, and difficulties so we can grow and become who we were meant to be. Those trials, those tests, and tribulations are being used to grow your faith. And here's the truth this morning. Committed faith is tested faith, and your faith will grow only when it's tested. Key number four this morning. A little Jesus is never enough. A little Jesus is never enough. I want to show you something very important this morning. Zechariah, hundreds of years earlier, prophesied Palm Sunday in great detail. Look at this. He said, rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout and triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey's colt. Now, let's read the story in Luke 19 and see how much it lines up. As he came down to the towns of Bethpage and Bethany on the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead. Go into the village over there, he told them. As you enter it, you will see a young donkey tied there that no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks, why are you untying that colt? Just say, the Lord needs it. So they went and found the colt, just as Jesus had said. And sure enough, as they were untying it, the owners asked them, why are you untying that colt? And the disciples simply replied, the Lord needs it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments over it for him to ride on. And as he rode along, the crowd spread out their garments on the road ahead of him. And when they reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in highest heaven. But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, "Teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that." And he replied, "If they kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers." But as he came closer to Jerusalem and saw the city ahead, he began to weep. See, as Jesus was riding into Jerusalem, he is literally fulfilling prophecy. Yet, just as he reaches the city, he weeps for Jerusalem. Why? Because they saw him, they cheered for him, and yet they missed him. Think about that. These Pharisees that are telling him to tell the crowds to stop, they were looking for the Messiah. They no doubt knew this prophetic scripture by heart. And right there, in front of them, scripture was being fulfilled, and they missed it. They saw him as a miracle worker, but not as a savior. And the crowds were caught up in the hype, and they missed a meeting. All of Israel knew his name, but they failed to see the mission. They witnessed the moment, and they ignored the encounter. And it makes me wonder this morning. It makes me wonder, how many encounters do I miss with Jesus? Moments where he was right there, guiding me, wanting to heal me, give me a second chance, and I missed him. See, for Jesus' faithful followers, they participated in a special moment in time, which tells me that if our eyes are open, we can have a life-changing encounter with Jesus. Friends, I wonder this morning, have you been comfortable with just a little Jesus? Have you been comfortable with just enough Jesus? Maybe you've missed moments. Maybe you've had moments, let me put it that way. Maybe you've had moments, but you haven't had an encounter that truly wrecks your life. See, Jesus, listen to me, Jesus didn't come to be your pal. He's here to be Lord. Jesus didn't come to be a partner. He wants to be in charge. Jesus didn't come to walk alongside of us. He came to guide us and lead us. And he isn't just a guy who rode in on a colt. He's a man who died on a cross so that your sins and my sins could be forgiven. This morning, I want you to know that Jesus has never been interested in a casual relationship with you. He died and he rose so he could have a fully committed, all-in, life-changing, eternal, radical, world-changing relationship with you. So I close this morning with this question. Why settle for a little Jesus when he died so you could have a rich, satisfying life that he offers you today? Would you bow your head, close your eyes this morning? Just very quickly, I'm not going to take a long time here because I have a feeling that everyone here, you've heard a challenge like this before, maybe online. But you're here this morning, you say, you know what, I've settled for a casual relationship with Jesus. Or maybe you're here and you say, you know what, I've pushed Jesus off and I grew up in the church or I had a relationship with him once upon a time, but I don't have one now. And you say, you know what, Pastor Paul, I want to have an all-in relationship with Jesus starting today. Very quickly this morning, if that's you, would you just signal? Let me see your hand this morning. Pray for me. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Pastor Paul, I want to step into an all-in relationship. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I don't want just the high moments. I want him to be there in the low moments too. Not where I'm blaming him or expecting him to take everything away, but where I know he walks with me during the difficult times. And he may not take it away, but yet, as Job said, I will not betray him. I will praise him. One second more. I want an all-in relationship with Jesus. Let me pray for you this morning. You could join in on this prayer too. Lord, you gave everything for us. Everything. You gave up the glories of heaven. You took on flesh. You became one of us. Yet you lived a sinless life so that you could die for us. Didn't end there. You rose again, victorious over death, hell, and the grave, so that we could have unfettered access to you and to the Father. And it didn't stop then. You have returned to heaven, and you're preparing a place for us that where you are, there we may be also for eternity. How could we give you anything less than all that we are? Forgive us this morning for mistaking a casual relationship for a committed relationship. Forgive us for thinking that it's about us and it's not about you. And forgive us for thinking that you don't have better for us. I pray this morning that we'd be all in, that we'd not miss the encounters when you're there, that we know your voice, we know your presence, we know your visitations, and we engage in those encounters. I thank you this morning. I thank you this morning that we don't have to settle for a little bit of Jesus, but that we get all of you, and that all of you is more than enough. I pray your blessing on your church this morning. Pray your blessing on this holy week. Go with us, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Okay, so last week, I told you I have a present for you this morning. I'm going to invite you to come down to the altar and take a little Jesus with you. And this little Jesus, no, start coming. And this little Jesus is going to be a reminder that we won't settle for a little Jesus, but that we want all of him. Now, you might have a color picked out. You better hurry up and get down here. Praise the Lord. This is the craziest altar call I've ever had. Come down and get a little Jesus. Moms and dads, please do me a favor. You're welcome to take some for your kids, but please make sure they're big enough not to choke on them. I don't want the lawsuit. I say that jokingly and not jokingly. Okay, you can take them for the kids that are big enough. Awesome. Hey, have a great Holy Week. Look forward to seeing you guys tonight at 6 o'clock. Wednesday night Bible study. Sunday. Nothing else this week, is there? Sunday. We'll see you Easter Sunday morning. 6 o'clock. 6:30, 8:30, 10 o'clock. Blessings. Have a good week.